indie cinema. Well, to put it shortly, an independent film is a movie that is made outside of the normal distribution groups, like Warner Brothers or Sony Pictures. A common example would be like Napoleon Dynamite.
Napoleon, give me some of your tots.
No, go find your own.
Come on, give me some of your tots.
No, I'm freaking starved. I didn't get to eat anything today.
Independent film. It was made with $400,000, released on June 11th, 2004, and it was distributed by Fox Searchlight Pictures is an independent film distribution company that was formed in 1994 by 20th Century Fox as a separate studio to produce art house independent cinema. Fox Searchlight Studios has helped many filmmakers like Guillermo del Toro, Alexander Payne, and my favorite on here, Wes Anderson. So yes, while not the best examples due to their budgets, they are still independent in ways that these filmmakers got to make the visions that they want to make without any big studio telling them that they can't do a certain thing. Now there's another company that was really good distributing indie films called Miramax, directed by OH DEAR GOD! Alright, same idea with Miramax. They founded the studio back in 1979 and they had made great films since. Same goals like Fox Searchlight, make indie studio independent films, get them successful, get them out there, and it worked out for them. People like Tarantino had been super successful, same thing with Soderbergh. And yeah, I'm rushing this right now because the original file got corrupted. Rest in peace. Thank you.
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you,
Morrow.
Oh, would you loosen up? You'd feel a hell of a lot better if you just rip into the occasional customer.
In general, big studios were able to take more risk buying off these indie projects due to them not having big studio projects yet to make. So Miramax and Fox Searchlight Pictures were the big studios producing films and getting high praise and awards for their cinematic achievements. Another reasons for these films' successes were for the festivals that aired them to investors and big movie lovers in general to see the light of day of these small projects to make a big impact. Film festivals like Sundance, Toronto International Film Festival, Cannes, and Fantasia were a huge help in the industry and showing these films to investors to see which big studio was going to buy them and hopefully see a future success. Okay, so it seems clear to me that the 90s was a golden age for indie cinema in general. A lot of studios were taking risks. Miramax and Fox Searchlight were the ones just going back and back and making hits after hits after hits. I mean, we're getting close to the 2000s. I hope the 2000s can be great. I mean, it has to be great, right? I mean, it has to be, right? 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 The year was 2011, a year in which it wasn't so exciting for movies. In particular, movies were not that great in that year. Netflix was born with the new advancements of accessing movies through streaming, tickets were getting pricey, the 3D experience felt more and more like a gimmick. Blockbusters like Transformers, Dark of the Moon, dumb name by the way, Green Lantern, We Bought a Zoo, Mars Needs Mom, Jack and Jill. Look, I can go on more in the bad movies that were released in 2011, and I can go on and on and on. But one day, three friends, David Frankel, Daniel Katz, and John Hodges, would say that it is time for film to change. I mean, we have the idea. We don't have the name. What should the name be? What should the name be? What should it be?
I got it!
And so in 2012, we had a group of three friends by the name of David Frankel, Daniel Katz, and John Hodges who lived in New York and wanted to make their own distribution company in order to bring back their love of indie cinema that they had in the 90s with Miramax and Fox Searchlight Studios. So these three had to do something. In order for them to get this company to get going, they had to buy movies, which is how companies usually work. You buy a film that someone already made, you then market it, and you just see if it makes any money. Now, for these three, there was originally two movies they wanted to buy. Francis Ha, directed by Noah Baumbach, written and acted by Greta Gerwig, and A Place Beyond the Pines. Although, unfortunately, those two films were already bought by IFC Films with Francis Ha, and Focus Features with The Place Beyond the Pines. So, with those films already bought, it seems like for them they didn't have any other films to really put out. Although, they did find someone, but this guy is like a complete weirdo. But, they had to get him going. No, shoot. But they needed a movie, and for desperate measures, they chose him. Harmony Corey. And so they had no other choice. They had to work with him. They couldn't get the rights to the other two films that they wanted, so Harmony Corey was the best option. Could have the film sucked? Sure. Could have not made money at all? Sure. Is it worth the risk? Sure. But what they wanted was something weird, different, and they had to work with what they got. With $5 million, they gave them the money and they prayed to God that this would hopefully work.
Look, for the third time, Mr. Watterson, rolling your stomach is not a valuable skill in the work environment.
Okay, quick update. This is the post-edit. So my teacher said I cannot make a video longer than I need to. If I'm not trying to be a TikTok video, he said no. If I did a video essay, which would be longer than 20 minutes, he said no. So we have to make it 20 minutes. So I'll just add the extra details in like some short thingy.
Brother, what's that? What's that, brother?
Hide.
What is wrong with you people? Afraid to look ugliness in the face? Well, here! Look at it! It's ugly, isn't it?
So what makes an A24 film an A24 film? Well, I don't know how to really answer that, so I'm going to show you clips for you to decide what makes their films, well, A24. I'm going to be presenting to you four films: Moonlight, Hereditary, Uncut Gems, and Everything Ever All at Once. These four films are the most successful of the company, and also good examples for me to show you what makes them unique. First off, artistic feel.
Got a dinosaur gym. Yes,
man. The dinosaurs, that's right. The dinosaurs stared at this. It's 110 million years old.
At the least. It was massive. Past the
block. Can't lean on glass paper.
We can also use artsy filmmaking at times like this. Next up, performances.
Say your name, Blue.
Nah.
At some point, you gotta decide for yourself who you gonna be. Can't let nobody make that decision for you.
You are getting fat. And you never call me, even though we have a family plan.
What?
And it's free. You only visit when you need something. You got a tattoo, and I don't care. If it's supposed to represent our family, you know I hate tattoos. And of all the places I could be, why would I want to be here with you? Yes, you're right. That doesn't make sense.
And by the way, that movie's about like hot dog fingers, rocks, and multiverses. Furthermore, atmosphere. I mention atmosphere because a lot of their films rely on a kind of atmospheric view of these characters and their world. So in cases like Uncut Gems, a lot of shots are close-ups of characters' faces to imply a very stressful atmosphere of you butting in with these people. Or in Everything Ever All at Once, you'll see a bunch of things around the atmosphere of the place. You might see googly eyes, or you might see some other hidden details around you. I'm going to try the best as I can to really summarize why each of these movies were successful. In terms of Moonlight, Moonlight won the award for Best Picture, and A24 got the opportunity to show it in more theaters, and especially due to performances and word of mouth, that was the reason why it had its success. In terms of Hereditary, Hereditary was just a new kind of horror film, showing insane imagery, and the use of grief as a theme to express horror was just something new for horror. And a lot of other horror movies will be using the grief theme a lot. Thanks, Hereditary. Thank you, Ari Aster. And in terms of Uncut Gems, I think you could tell they had the funny man, Adam Sandler. I mean, he's a big sell for this movie, and he was also the reason why many people went to go see it. But also with its stressful atmosphere, it really engaged the audience. And then with Everything Ever All at Once, it was just a multiverse movie, but it wasn't like some regular old superhero movie like the disappointment that was Multiverse of Madness. You know, you have $200 million and you let like a $25 million movie beat you. Come on, man. But anyways, for that movie's success, I mean, it explains itself. I mean, it was everything. They go everywhere, and they do it all at once. Another big reason for A24's most successful films also come from the directors that get to create their ideas. Without Ari Aster, Barry Jenkins, the Safdie brothers, and the Daniels, all of those filmmakers wouldn't have been able to help A24 become as successful as they were. You could argue that they're the reason why their company is as popular as they are in the first place. Their creative integrity is what helped these films be recognizable as they are today.
So back in 2019, I was just sitting around in my house. My sister asked me, "Do you want to watch a movie?" I said, "Sure." We went down and we watched this movie called The Lighthouse. And this film has forever changed my life and appreciation for film in general. My complex question would be, how could people find more kinds of movies to watch than what they're already comfortable with? Well, the answer would be simple, and that would be the answer to social media.
I mean, there are many ways people can find recommendations throughout social media. That could be through review sites or even just regular things like TikTok, Twitter, etc., etc. Specifically, let's focus on one kind of site that has been big in the 2020s, Letterboxd. Letterboxd is an online media site dedicated to film lovers or people who are interested in finding movies that they might like. Founded by two New Zealanders, Matthew Buchanan and Carl Von Rendeau, back in 2011, the website has since become one of the biggest review sites for people to tune in on the latest receptions of upcoming films in the 2020s. Letterboxd works very simple. You make an account, you choose your four favorite movies, someone else will say your taste is bad, and you look what else your friends have logged for that day. None of these are my friends, by the way.
So now I have to say that this site has been very helpful in getting more people into films. Although my issue with the site would have to be the reviews themselves. You either get some pretty good reviews or you get stupid stuff like this. Yeah, most of this site is just for memes. It's not bad, I mean, most of the age group in this is young. But it's not exactly the best way to get insight on whether you know a movie is good or not. So that's why there are other sites that are better to check out whether movies.
And then there's IMDb. Now IMDb I find to be a lot of a better site than most review sites, as they give much more insightful reviews, in my opinion, as many people type actual opinions on the movie rather than memes like Letterboxd does. YouTube is also a place where you can find many reviews and such, although the issue is just gonna be you personally. You're either gonna like the channel's review or not. That's all just up to you. Alrighty, my final moments. My final thoughts. 1. I learned to like editing. Throughout this project, I learned many editing tricks, and I want to do more video editing in the future. 2. I learned that not all independent films can be a very small budget. They can range from $200,000 to over $50 million. And 3. The purpose of this video. I learned that there's always different things you can try in life, whether it comes to food, whether it comes to taking risk, whether it comes to making new friends. There's always different and new things you can do in life, and when it comes to entertainment, there's always different kinds of things you can try. Not everything you're gonna like, you're gonna like. I got into cinema myself more in the 2020s due to a lot of independent films that I've watched throughout the pandemic. But that doesn't mean that everybody's gonna watch it, and that's okay. At least that I hope that there'd be more kinds of people that watch it. But there could be different kinds of movies you can watch in general that can widen your variety of things to enjoy. And the thing that I really want to end off this video with is a montage of all the different kinds of films you can watch. Whether it relates to genre, its independent filmmaking, or just in general, just how good it is. I really have to thank you for watching this video, and I see you all in this montage.